You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, everybody. Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, or whenever you're watching this. I think that's actually a line from The Truman Show. I'll have to look that up. If you have questions today for me, you can email, askdhtvlive@gmail.com. Askdhtvlive@gmail.com. That's the easiest way to ask questions, and I will do my best to answer them. Before we start with the lecture today, there's also a phone number they put on the screen too, 310-516-4205. You can ask questions that way too. Couple things I want to go over because I've gotten some questions. I know that the first reaction paper is not due until February 14th, but I would love everybody to get a perfect score. And so I want to go over some of the issues that have come up in questions to George and I over the time so that I can have a sense of at least it's gone out once over the airwaves. So if we can flip over to the screen, there are a couple people who have made comments. One about activity one. Activity one is taking the online survey. The question that we get asked is, well, can I go back and see what I answered because I need to know what I answered to do activity two? And my answer is no, you can't go back to see what you answered, but we're not going to check either. So do your best to recollect it, or if you want to, you can take the sample of the survey here. It says reaction paper survey copy, which is right here. And if you're really neurotic and obsessive compulsive, as you're doing the survey online, you could also check it off on here, and that'll help you remember if you want, but you don't really need to do that. That's obsessive compulsive, and I don't think it's necessary. As George and I have been asked to read some sample papers from some of you, we found a couple of things that are common mistakes. So I want to go through the activity two part, your actual paper, and go through again just so we're sure that we're all on the same page. So first of all, on number one, your number one is really simple. Basically, you're going to pick one question out of questions 2 through 6, one question out of questions 7 through 10, et cetera. And all you're going to do there is tell us which ones you picked. That's all. So I picked question 2, 10, 11, 14, and 23. That's all you need to say there. On the second one, though, now you're going to take, this is going to be the longest part of what you write. Now you're going to take everything. So say you did question 2. Let's see. Here's question 2. So say you did question 2. Now what you're going to do is go back and say how you answered question 2. And again, it doesn't have to be exact. You should be able to remember that you answered, you know, all the time for some of them, or once a week, or around here. You don't have to be exact. We're not looking for 100% perfection here. But what you want to do is talk about how you answered all of these. It'll be helpful if you can do it as a group. This one, for example, all refers to email questions about email. And so if you pick number 2, you could answer briefly, say, well, I answered most of these emails around once a day or several times a day, and here's why. I don't check it very often, and here's why I don't check it very often, because it's mostly junk and I don't need it, or whatever your reason is. So that's going to be a pretty hefty section under number 2. Some of them will be more, some of them will be less, but every one of these questions has multiple possible answers except for one, and you can figure out which one that is. 3 and 4 is where you need to be more thinking. We need you to put on your thinking cap and really talk about your feelings about these things. And I very carefully use, what do you feel drives your behaviors to do or not do these activities? Describe your relationship. These are your opinions. There's no right or wrong answer. The right answer is if you write a bunch about how you feel, if you write a bunch about your relationship, if you address all the issues in here. Does it interfere with your life? In what ways does it or does it not? We're just looking to see that you answered the question in enough detail that we can go, yeah, that person thought about the question. So if you have any questions about yours, I have office hours from 9 to 10 before, or 9 to roughly 9 to 10 before class and 2:15 to 3 after my lab meeting. Feel free to drop over. If you want to email me or email George or both of us and ask us if your answer to a particular question is fine, we'll be glad to take a quick look at it. We won't edit it for you, but we'll take a quick look and tell you, yeah, it's roughly good, roughly bad for this reason, this reason. And for those of you who have already submitted it and realized, ooh, I didn't really answer exactly what he wanted, you get an extra chance or even two extra chances to redo it and submit it again. We will only read the latest one that comes in. So hopefully that will all make sense, and hopefully we're gonna get all papers that have 20s. That's what I'm looking for. If there are any questions, we'll be glad to handle them. Otherwise, let's move on and talk about some fun topics. So today I wanna talk about at least one topic and maybe get into the last two. The first one is online relationships. And this has become very important in our world because relationships now typically don't start face-to-face, they start online, or they're consummated online, or they're maintained online. If we get a chance, we'll talk a little bit about internet addiction and family systems theory as a prelude to some of the other work we're going to talk about, but I may just get through the online relationships part today and call it quits. So, let's talk a little bit about online relationships. Online dating is exceedingly popular. The dating sites don't keep really good statistics, so it's hard to tell the actual stats. But if you just ask all your friends how they met their last relationship, you will find that a large majority of them started the relationship online. I'm a good example of that. I met my fiance through Match.com. I have four kids. Three of them met their spouses through three different online services. And that's pretty typical, pretty common now. I'm going to talk a little bit about the different online dating sites, but there's also this new idea, not so new anymore, of where you look at a picture or very limited information about someone and you either swipe one way or swipe the other to indicate whether you want to continue with that person, to converse with them, to send them a message, to engage them, to hook up with them, to whatever. Then also in this same realm of talking about online relationships is sexting, and we're going to talk considerably about this concept of sexting. I encourage you when you read the chapter in the book, I believe it's chapter 4, when you get through the chapter, there's an interview at the end of each chapter with an expert. This one in this chapter is really important. It's Dr. Michelle Druin, who is the expert on sexting. And she has given probably the longest interview in the whole book. And I think it's an excellent interview. She's a really interesting researcher, a really interesting person, and really started the field, started the research in this field, and is really my go-to expert whenever I need information about sexting or even online relationships. So please do read her interview. Of course, it's all fair game for the exam. And again, even though we've been asked a million times, yes, there will be a study guide for the exam, and yes, I will tell you which chapters and what parts of which chapters are important in the book. For now, you should be reading the chapters in the book that are going to be on the first test, which I think are 1, 2, 4, and 9 or something like that. I don't know. Look into the syllabus, it'll tell you. Two other issues that we're going to talk about. One is virtual sex or cyber sex and how the technology has allowed that. And then I'm going to talk a bit about pornography, but in a different way. I'm going to talk about some of the research on pornography and what we've found. So let's go back to the screen. Let's talk about online dating. Believe it or not, online dating technically started in 1976, except it really wasn't online. It was a system called Great Expectations, where you went in, you recorded a video of yourself answering questions, talking, and then people would come in and look at videos of people of whatever sex they wanted to date. And based on the video, they would put in a request for a date. And so it would be very dry. Some of the videos were funny. They helped you put together your video. Some of them were very bland. And you'd use that to get a small sense of the person and what they were like. Between 76 and 95, there was very little movement on the online dating scene. There were a couple websites that came and went really quickly that tried to provide a social site for online dating, but really the only one that really hit big was Match.com, which is still the biggest one. And again, sorry, but they don't give out statistics on how many people they have. In fact, since I was on Match.com, if I look at my profile, it's still there. It's just hidden from people. And they count those hidden profiles as still active profiles for some reason. So they always claim they have millions of people. But Match.com started in 1995, which means it's almost a quarter of a century old. Followed a few years later by eHarmony, which had a very different approach. First of all, it was based on somewhat on religiousness. Kind of the expectation was if you were using eHarmony, you were probably someone who had a strong religious belief. And second, before they even let you look at any of the profiles that were on there, you had to take a questionnaire, 180 questions, 200 questions. And based on the answers to your questions, they would immediately come up with suggested matches for you. They abandoned that approach a while back, I believe. But it was, again, a different way to provide competition to Match.com. Nobody ever really provided competition. I mean, there was Ashley Madison, which was big in the news because they got hacked and all the information came out. That was a system created in early 2002 that was just designed for people to have affairs, very simply. And then there are lots of others, OkCupid, Badu, Grindr, Tinder. Each one has its own purpose. I believe there's even one online dating for farmers. It's a pretty big, expansive system now. And there is a lot of interesting research on online dating with very meaningless results. So I'm going to give you one of the studies that I think is probably the most salient, one because it was my study, but two because I think it really tackled the main issues that we were talking about. So if we can come back to me for a second. Oh, wait, I have a question. Oh, question is, my TA asked a question. I'd like to add that if you do not answer all four questions completely, full credit will be a tough get. That's for the reaction paper. And so he's just telling you, please answer all four of the questions. And I'm telling you also, question number two is super important, but questions three are your opinions, and you should not skimp on your opinions. So I think we've covered it. We expect you to do really exceptionally well on this paper because it's relatively straightforward. We wanted to start with an easier one. So let me talk a little bit about the online dating research. This was done probably about 10 years ago, and it's called zero acquaintance impression formation. Basically what it is it's a setup with some vignettes, and I'm going to show you some of the vignettes and read them to you, where you have people who are both online daters and not online daters look at sample email messages from one person to another. It's called zero acquaintance, as you'll see, because it's the first email that somebody writes. So it's their initial impression that they're trying to get across to somebody to engage them, to get their attention. In this study, it was actually a series of four studies, but the ones I want to highlight deal with the structure and the wording in the messages that somebody sent. It deals on two levels, one with emotionality, and you'll see an example of that, and a second is self-disclosure. And the concept is basically the same. What you do is you set up an initial message, and I'll give you an example. So here's an initial message you can see on the screen from Jenny123, and she would say, hi, whoever, in this case, Jim or Frank, whoever she's emailing. Hi, Jim, I read your profile and I'm interested in hearing more about you. Please email back when you get a chance. Just real standard. What would happen is we would then put in Jim's message back to her and Frank's message back, and those messages would differ only in this case, in the level of emotionality. And you'll see what I mean by emotionality when I read them to you. But basically, there were seven words that we changed. We kept the content roughly the same, the number of words roughly the same, the meaning, the person's job, the person's social status, all the same. And all we did is change seven words. I'll show you an example of that in a second. After the subject would read this, there would be 18 adjectives, and they would be asked, you've just read Jim's response to Jenny. Which of these adjectives do you think apply to Jim? And now you've read Frank's response to Jenny. Which of these adjectives do you think apply to Frank? So let me show you what Jim wrote. It says, and we tried to keep it neutral, so just Jim J789, so it's no fancy name or anything. Hi, Jenny. I'm 35 years old and manage a shoe store with 12 employees. I love my job. There's one of the words. I love my job and find that the time goes quickly. When I'm not working, I read exciting, that's another word, novels and travel. Travel excites me since it allows me to see places and people that I read about. I feel like I have a fantastic life with friends, a good job, and wonderful hobbies. I'm looking for a woman to share my terrific life. Are you that person? Please tell me more about you. So that's Jim, and we would call him a high emotionality person. If you look, there are actually seven adjectives that I accented, so you could see how Jim was. Now let's take a look at Frank. Frank XYZ, again, just to keep it relatively neutral. Hello, Jenny. Well, I'm in my mid-30s. I have a 9-to-5 job as a manager at a men's clothing store at the mall. I would say that I'm satisfied with my job. Not excited, not love my job, satisfied with my job. After 5 o'clock, I get to spend time doing what I want. Usually I choose to watch movies, most of which I find to be good. I also like to travel. After I go on a vacation, I feel very content that I've done something I like. I like my life and enjoy being with my friends. I'm looking for someone who would be pleased to join me in my life. Are you that person? Please tell me more about you. So you get a sense now that Frank and Jim are different. Not all that different, by the way. It's not all that different. If you look at the whole meat of the conversation of the zero acquaintance email, what you really see is that they're both positive people. So now, if you look at the results, they're really fascinating. Jim was found to be more confident, happy, enthusiastic, cheerful, energetic, excited, interesting, proud, determined, bold, and daring. Just from that, while Frank was found to be more calm, relaxed, at ease, shy, and nervous. Now, the real important question is, at the end they were asked, who should Jenny respond to? If she could only respond to one of them, who should she respond to? What's your guess? Well, 71% said that she should respond to Jim and only 29% to Frank. That's pretty astounding, quite honestly. And surprised us a bit because, again, the message was just seven adjectives that we changed. The rest, as you notice, was all the same. They were both managers of stores. They both had things that they enjoyed to do. They both liked to go on vacations, et cetera. Everything was kept constant. So then we wanted to look at self-disclosure because that's a big thing on online dating. How much do you talk about yourself? So we created somebody called Susan P. And Susan was writing three men, Mark, Robert, and Edward. And I'll give you there so you can get a sense. So she would say, hi, Mark. I read your profile. I'm interested in hearing more about you. Please email back when you get a chance. Again, the same kind of thing. So now we look at Robert123, who's high self-disclosure. And I'm going to read this to you. I'm going to read all three to you because in order to get them on one screen, I needed to make the print kind of small. You can see it on the PowerPoints that are on Blackboard, of course, if you want to read them. But just listen to the level of self-disclosure here. And remember, this is the first email. This is the zero acquaintance email. So, hi, Susan. At the ripe old age of 31, oh, by the way, we balanced all of these. All three of these are balanced for number of words, again, for the socioeconomic status of the person, of their likes, their dislikes, etc. Hi, Susan. At the ripe old age of 31, I'm the top manager for a very successful business making airplane parts. I love my work. It's fun and challenging, and I feel that I get a lot of emotional satisfaction out of it. Sometimes after work, I go to the gym and work out. Really helps me feel so much more alive and also helps tone up my body. That's important to me. I also like sports. I'm up for almost any sport, although I prefer basketball and touch football. On the weekend, I like to relax, have fun, and maybe go out to a movie. I really like movies about relationships, although I do enjoy a good thriller too. I'm not married and have no children. I did date a woman. This is where we get into the self-disclosure part. I did date a woman for 2.5 years a while back, but I was very unhappy that we were not emotionally closer. I was simply more positive and more willing to talk about my goals and feelings. She was more closed off. For example, I would tell her that I was lonely and she would change the topic. We were good in the beginning and were affectionate. We would kiss for hours. I'm a passionate person. As you may be able to tell, I have no trouble talking about my feelings. Anyway, tell me your deepest, darkest secrets. I look forward to hearing from you. So that's clearly very high self-disclosure, as you can tell. Not uncommon, by the way, on these kind of services, that often the first message is very self-disclosing, and that can, we're going to look in this research at how that influenced, in this case, Susan, or the people reading about Susan, in terms of who she should pick and the adjectives that reflected this person. So now we go to Mark, who's more moderate self-disclosure. Hi, Susan. I have a very good job as a vice president of finance for a mid-sized pharmaceutical company. It's a 9-to-5 job, and it pays well enough to allow me to do all the things that I like to do. At 35, that is important to me. I like to ski, watch sports, and go to the movies. Again, you can see that the beginning is sort of the same for everybody. I really like anything outdoors. I have a few really good friends and like to spend time with them when we all can work it out. Sometimes we just hang around, but often we go out and get into a pickup basketball game at the park. It's great exercise, and I really feel good after I play. Personally, I've been in one long-term relationship but never married. We met in college and stayed together for almost 3 years. However, when I decided to get an MBA and had to study constantly, she got very upset. It affected all parts of our life together. We would argue about everything, and quite honestly, I didn't like it. She really didn't seem to understand my life goals. It also affected our sex life. She no longer seemed to want to make love, and when we did, it wasn't very tender at all. Felt pretty upset as we had planned a future together. So that's me in a nutshell. What about you? So again, self-disclosure, but not nearly as much for Mark as for Robert. And now we go to Edward, who's the lowest self-disclosure. Hi, Susan. I'm 32 years old and an attorney. I practice corporate law and really like what I do. It is fun and challenging. Every day brings something new, and that makes the days go by quickly. I am tall and slender and exercise regularly. I like movies, particularly those that talks about sports and intrigue. I'm happiest when I have enough time to do all the things that I like to do. On the weekends, I love to work out and then maybe take in a movie. I have lots of friends and we like hanging out together. I even play a little softball in a local league. All in all, I like where I am in life. I was married once and quite honestly, it was a mistake from the beginning. We really had nothing in common and could not make it work. We stayed married for 2 years, but the last year was rather difficult. We did not talk much and mostly stayed out of each other's way. Finally, we realized we could not make it work and got the divorce. We are not friends, but we are not angry at each other. It simply did not work. Other than that, I think I'm a pretty even keel guy. I like what I saw on your profile and would like to talk more. Are you interested? So here you can see that Edward has very low self-disclosure, really tries to talk about himself a little bit, but it's not very much and not in depth. If you compare it back to Robert and even Mark, you find a big, huge difference in the amount and the feeling of self-disclosure. So the question then becomes, what do we find? So again, rating on adjectives, Robert, who was the high self-disclosure, was rated as more positive, cheerful, happy, and open. Mark was followed there, and then Edward got all the adjectives that were very mild or non-existent. So who do you think was supposed to be chosen? So first of all, in this study, we had both traditional daters, meaning face-to-face daters, and online daters. So when you looked at everybody together, if you lumped all of them in one group, overall, they were about split. Edward, the least self-disclosing, was picked more often, but Robert, the most self-disclosing, was second, and Mark, the middle self-disclosing, was third. But those differences aren't very huge. Interestingly enough, when you look at the online daters, Edwards was picked by 41% of the online daters, meaning online daters do not like massive self-disclosure in the first email from someone. What we also did is we then did the study where we reversed it, and instead of having a woman writing to three men, we had a man writing to three women. And just to share with you the results, for the online daters, 48% of them picked the lowest self-disclosure man. So what you're, I'm sorry, woman. So what you're seeing is that emotionality is good. Being positive, having words like, I love my job, I really have a great life. That's considered good and a positive trait in the beginning of an online relationship. What's not considered good is self-disclosure. And yet, what's interesting is if you go to the online dating sites and you start looking at some of the profiles that people write, they spend a lot of time self-disclosing. They write about all their likes, they write about themselves. They think they're trying to ensnare the person in by being so revealing, and particularly men do this a lot more than women. And in fact, it turns out that the readers at the other end don't really like that. So I think that's interesting. There are a bunch of issues that I want to talk about that are important in online relationships. The first is something that you're going to read about in the book a lot, and I think it's very important to talk about, which is the reason for starting a relationship online is what's called sexual identity formation. It's basically the idea that what's happening is by your writing online, by your sharing online, by what you do in your online relationships, not your face-to-face relationships, but your online relationships, are helping you craft your sexual identity before you're willing to take it into the real world. And I think that's a really important part to read in the book. I encourage you to read that section of the book because it does a really good job, and rather than repeat myself, I want to add some more information for you. Recognize, like I said last time, that all of this takes place behind a screen. That you are sitting in front of a screen. I don't care what kind of screen it is, if it's a phone screen, if it's a tablet screen, if it's a computer screen, if it's a television screen, it doesn't really matter. You're sitting in front of a screen. Because you're sitting in front of a screen, you don't see who's at the other end. And what happens is you feel somewhat anonymous. And even if you know who's at the other end of the screen, this feeling of anonymity helps you be more self-disclosing. It helps you put yourself out there and be more self-disclosing because, after all, they can't see you. So you can't see their facial expressions. You can't see the cues coming from them. You might get a cue that says, hey, dude, that's TMI, but that's also pretty bland. So part of being behind the screen is you're more self-disclosing. The other thing that being behind a screen does, and the research shows this convincingly, is that it makes you more willing to take risks. Some of those risks might be good risks in the sense of, well, you know, here's this really good-looking woman on Match.com. I'm going to write her. I wouldn't have a chance with her in the real world, but maybe if I write her and wow her with my prose and how I am, I can get a chance with her. So you're more willing to take good risks, also more willing to take bad risks. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. In the book, the author talks about what's called the AAA engine that drives all of this, and that is availability, meaning that there's just a lot of services available, there's a lot of people available out there online. Anonymity, which I've talked about, that you feel anonymous, so you feel more like you can either be yourself, or we'll talk about what kind of self you want to portray. In psychology, we talk about, a lot about different kinds of selves that we have. You can either be more your real self, or you can be a different kind of self if you want to be. And then there's affordability, because basically it's all free. Many of the online dating sites cost, but many of them are free. And a lot of people end up meeting on sites that aren't even traditionally dating sites, like social media sites that are all free. Online dating is basically how you manage the impression you give to others. And you can see from the study that I gave you that Jim managed his impression by using a lot of positive adjectives. Robert managed his impression by self-disclosing a lot. Edward managed his impression by not self-disclosing a lot. So a lot of it is how you what you disclose, how you decide what to present yourself as. And I remember when I was going on Match.com and I was writing my profile, I shared it with a couple people before I uploaded it, and one of the people said, basically, you're saying too much. You need to cut it down. You're saying too much about yourself. It sounds like you're bragging. And so I cut it down considerably. And it's funny because several times while I had my Match.com profile up there, it was very clear that I was attracting a certain kind of person who was responding to the zero acquaintance information that I had posted up there. every time I changed it, it felt like I attracted a different kind of person, which in retrospect, I mean, this was 17 years ago, 18 years ago. In retrospect, had I known then what I know now from research, I might have crafted it differently. I might have used less self-disclosure, but more positive adjectives. I think that's sort of interesting to learn that. So let's talk a little bit about sexual attitudes and behaviors. In general, the internet is what's called a sexual media diet, an SMD. The internet, television, movies, rock videos, any kind of visual media, even non-visual media, provides a complicated sexual media diet. There's evidence that sexuality is changing rapidly. 41% of teens, according to a 2018 Center for Disease Control survey, have had sexual intercourse. It's, if you actually expand that to other kinds of sex acts, it increases enormously. And there's a sort of a controversy when you look at researchers talking about sex, particularly among teenagers, of what's considered sex. And one of the predominant themes that I've been reading about is that it's the way you ask the question. If you ask the question, have you had vaginal sexual intercourse, then that's a straightforward question that the teens can answer. If you ask the question, have you had sex, it depends on their definition of sex. And in many cases, the definition of sex includes everything but vaginal sexual intercourse. So there's also a change in sort of sexual attitudes, and this is all goes along with this swiping left, swiping right concept of some of the apps that are available. There's a much looser kind of attitude towards sex, and again, it depends on how you define sex, but there's people just hooking up with no emotional attachments, or sort of a mix between, or a halfway between having a friend and having a lover. You have a friend with benefits. So what I want to do is give you a picture of some of the research in the past. There's been a ton of research done on sexuality and television sexuality and movies. Some of it's older, some of it's newer. I'm not even going to give you the dates. I'm just going to give you the themes. And what I'm going to try to do is explain to you a little bit each of the studies and how they were done. There's quite a few. So the first one is they used, in this case, teenagers and young adults, and they asked them two questions. One question was, how much television do you watch a day? They didn't ask them what they watch, just how much television do you watch a day. And then they asked them to estimate the prevalence of people their age who are having sexual intercourse. And those who watched more television overestimated the prevalence of sexual intercourse. Those who watched less television underestimated. It's called a correlational study. Doesn't prove causality. Doesn't mean watching television makes you overestimate how much sexual intercourse is going on. Doesn't do that. What it does is it says, those who watch more TV have this, those who watch less TV have this, they go together. There may be a reason why they go together. You'll actually read about this in the author of the book talks about this. It's correlational research only. So let me give you another one. Now when they looked at groups of, these are young adults, they looked at if they watched X-rated movies or not. Those who watched X-rated movies were more accepting of infidelity and promiscuity. Those who watched less or no X-rated movies were less accepting. Again, correlational. It doesn't mean that watching an X-rated movie makes you one way or the other. It just means they go together. In this case, this is actually a research study where they showed a group of, again, young adults. These were young adult males, actually. They showed them an R-rated movie or part of an R-rated movie and found that those who watched the R-rated movie versus a PG-rated movie had more lenient attitudes towards rape, which was a staggering result when it was found. This is an interesting result, and this is a study that I think is exceedingly important. And that is, does it matter whether you see someone having sex on television or hear people talking about having sex on television? And it turns out that when you look at the research across lots of studies of this, that it really doesn't matter. That if you get the same exact effect hearing people talk about having sex as actually seeing people having simulated intercourse on TV or on porn even, it's the concept planted in your brain about sexuality that makes the difference. And I'm going to talk about some of these results, and I'm going to talk about some theories to explain the results and why they happen. So they had a study where they had male adolescents watch sexy women on TV versus non-sexy women. I don't know how they define non-sexy and sexy, but they did. And those who watched the sexy women on TV then were asked to rate the attractiveness of women that they might date. They didn't know them, but they were just pictures of women that were their age, were age appropriate for dating. And they had lower rating of the attractiveness of potential dates than the adolescents who watched non-sexy women. Again, subtle differences, but this is the impact of the sort of images on, in this case, television, but images on the screen that can affect your attitudes. They do a lot of research on young girls and beauty. And in this one, they asked girls to keep a diary about any of the commercials that they watched during a week-long period. And those who watched more commercials or saw more commercials about beauty products felt that it was more important to look good in order to get a boyfriend. And the same thing for boys. Those boys who watched more buff men on TV, not in commercials, but actually buff men on TV as TV stars, had an increased belief that being muscular was better for them to get the girls. A little bit more for you. Just some stats. Adolescents are exposed to 143 incidents of sexual behavior on network TV at prime time each week. Prime time on TV used to be time that you couldn't even talk about sex. If you go back to the 50s and 60s, Lucy and Desi were not even allowed to sleep in the same bed. If two people on TV were in the same bed, one had to have one foot on the floor. It was a very complicated relationship between the medium of television and human sexuality. And in this case, obviously things have changed, and primetime TV, which is typically since nobody watches TV live anymore, it's a little ludicrous to talk about primetime TV, but primetime TV is replete with sexual innuendos, sexual talk, and sexual episodes. Excuse me. So let's see what the next study says. Ah, yes. There is an interesting branch of study that has not been done for a while, so this is relatively old work. It's called the Lolita effect. Lolita is a 13-year-old girl character from a Vladimir Nabokov Russian novel where a man falls in love with Lolita and has sexual relationships with her. And Lolita is very sexy and very provocative. And if you just look at the names of the women here who are stars, you can see that they dress provocatively. They put on, I remember Miley Cyrus just hosted Saturday Night Live and was singing, and the jacket that she wore over nothing barely stayed on. She was certainly sexually provocative, and she's not young anymore, but she's still young. Another correlational study here that for girls, these are young girls in high school, that those who watch more TV sexual content, they looked at what you watched on TV. Usually they do this with diary studies. They have you write down everything you watch. And those who had watched more of a total sexual content were more likely to get pregnant in the next 3 years, which is twice the odds of those watching less sexual content. So just watching it. And then there's some culturally specific studies. They're very few, by the way, but this one I think was particularly controversial, that African-American teens with multiple sexual partners are the ones who have watched more TV shows with women as sexual objects. Again, correlational work, but important. This is a study that came out recently, and if you look, these are the ages of teenagers from 12 to 17. On the side is the percentage of virgins initiating intercourse in the subsequent year, and you can see that those who have more TV sex exposure, their line is higher at all ages than lower TV sex exposure, meaning they're more likely to initiate sexual intercourse within the next year. So there's a lot of strong research on television. Teens, both boys and girls who watch porn, want to try what they saw. This is an interesting one that has to do with video games. There's a lot of video games out there that are replete with sexuality. The ones that I remember, and these are probably dating myself since I don't really play video games, but Grand Theft Auto had a game that my son showed me once, where the object was to run over prostitutes as you were driving your car. They found in research studies with a lot of the Grand Theft Auto ones, they found that boys who played more video games with these sexy prostitutes out there had more stereotypical views of girls. Teen boys and young men who see centerfolds, Playboy centerfolds, Hustler centerfolds, whatever, rated their girlfriends as less attractive after they saw the centerfold than before. And then in terms of violence, and we're going to get into this later on in the semester, we talk about violence in video games. We're going to talk more about the promotion of how violence in video games promote violence in real life, potentially. But those young males who watch more violent video games were more likely to have multiple sex partners and more likely to get STDs also. There's been a little scant research on videos, on music videos. This was done actually back when music videos were confined to TV channels like MTV, and young male teenagers who watched more music videos ended up initiating more sexual contact with girls than those who watched less. Interestingly enough, and I don't tout this study as a good one, but I'm put it up here because I think it's an interesting one. This was done about 10 years ago, before texting became sort of a manic kind of activity, but they looked at those who sent more than 100 texts a day versus those who sent less than 100 texts a day. And they found that those who sent more than 100 texts a day had more what they call sexual risk behaviors. These are often having sex in risky places, not using condoms. There's a whole slew of sort of sexual risky behaviors. The interesting thing is that if the parents monitored text messages, that this effect did not hold. And then adolescents who use more social media end up being more dissatisfied with their bodies. We're going to talk a lot about the impact of social media on everything, from how you feel about the way you look, your self-esteem, everything. So let's talk a little theory. One of the things that I like to do in this class is to introduce you to how theorists have explanations for this. And I want to start off by telling you that a theory is just an idea. It's an idea that someone has about what might explain behavior. It's neither true or false, and research can't prove it to be true or false. What research does is it supports a theory or it doesn't support a theory. So for example, there's a theory called social learning theory, the first one here done by Al Bandura. What social learning theory says is, can we come back to me a little here? Thank you very much. What social learning theory says is that we learn things by imitating other people, by imitating other people's behavior. So if you think about this in terms of the 18 or 19 studies that I just went through, what Bandura would suggest is that the way we express, or young teens, young adults, express their sexuality comes from imitating what they see on television, music videos, the internet, wherever. So it's completely based on that. And in particular, it's backed up by what's called behaviorism, or behavioral research, or behavioral theory, or operant conditioning theory. There's a lot of titles for it, which suggests that if you have a positive effect of a behavior, meaning you do something and it gives you a positive effect, whether you get something you want physically, you get something you want mentally, emotionally, then you are more likely to do it again. That's called positive reinforcement. If you do something, you get a good result, you're more likely to do it again and again and again. So you can see how this fits in with social learning theory. It's less about you doing something and more about you imitating somebody who's done something and themselves gotten a positive effect. So you watch somebody on a TV show, they build their muscles up, they get the girl in the end, then your feeling is going to be, well, I want to build my muscles up so I can be like him, because then if I'm like him, I'll get the girl in the end. So it's not doing the act yourself, but imitating somebody doing it. It's a classic study that kind of shows this with young children called the Bobo doll study. I don't know if you know what a Bobo doll is, but a Bobo doll is a big inflatable doll, usually a couple feet, 3 feet tall. On the bottom, it has a base that contains sand. And so it sits up, and if you hit it one way, it goes down and bounces back up. If you hit it the other way, it goes down and bounces back up. I don't know where the name Bobo doll came from. It's an old toy. It's been around forever. Study done, still classic study done, I believe, in the 70s, where they had children come into the lab, young children, but the study's been replicated with children of many ages. They have them come into the lab, and they split them into three separate groups. One group goes in and watches a violent video. Oftentimes with kids, this would be a video of a real video of people being violent to each other, hurting each other, hitting each other, physical violence with real people. Another group will watch similar physical violence, but cartoon violence. So like a Roadrunner cartoon where you know there's a lot of violence in it. They were matched, by the way, the two videos were matched for the amount of violent acts, the number of times somebody got hit and pushed and whatever. And then the third group would watch a neutral video, usually something like a Mr. Rogers TV show or something like that. So then what they would do is they would take these kids and bring them all into a room together, to one big room. And in the room, there were lots of toys, and they would just say, play with the toys. And what they were really interested in is the Bobo doll. Bobo doll would be in the center of the room, much more salient than any other toys. And what they were looking at is who would hit the Bobo doll. Because that's what you're supposed to do. Bam, you hit the Bobo doll, it bounces back up. Bam, you hit it again. So guess who hit the Bobo doll most? Well, if you guessed the ones who watched the real violence, you're wrong. It's both the ones who watched the real violence and the cartoon violence hit the Bobo doll more. The ones who saw Mr. Rogers, the nonviolent show, hardly hit the Bobo doll at all. So again, that's imitation, that's social learning. The idea is they learned from watching the real violence or the cartoon violence, and just by watching it, then they went and imitated it. Okay, so that's social learning theory. Second theory here is called schema or script theory. This is attributed to Jean Piaget, who is the classic developmental psychologist. Everybody should know who Piaget is. It's not a watch, it's a person. Piaget's idea was that we were all born with what he called schemas in our heads. And babies are born with very few schemas. One of the schemas is a schema on how to suck. If you have a newborn baby and you put your finger in their mouth, they will immediately suck your finger. That is a natural reaction. But Piaget would call that a schema. And then he would say, well, and if you take the baby and put the baby to the breast, the baby will suck. That's part of that same schema. What Piaget says is that as babies get exposed to more and more, they develop more schemas, or they take information that that come into their world and put it in another schema. So for example, if you give the baby a pacifier and it sucks, that's not a new schema. That goes into the schema of sucking, the sucking schema. If you start smiling at the baby and the baby smiles, then that might create a new schema called a smiling schema. Piaget's idea is you build up these schemas over time. He uses two terms, assimilation and accommodation. You either assimilate new experiences into an existing schema, or you accommodate new experiences into their own schemas. As you get older, these schemas change, and some of them become what are called scripts. You know what a movie script is or a TV script is? It's a complete direction from the first scene of everything that happens. It's first the lights go on, then this happens, then the man walks into the room, then this, then this, then this, then this person says this. It's a step-by-step, in-order log of what happens. What Piaget and many Piagetians would say is that we develop scripts in our head, and scripts are directions of what we're supposed to do. You have scripts, and you will know this if I give you a couple of examples. A couple of my favorite examples. When you take a shower, do you do things in the shower in random order, or do you do it in the same order every time? I get in the shower. First thing I do is grab the shampoo. I know I don't have much hair, but I put the shampoo on my hair. Then I take the soap, and I was watching myself this morning doing this. Then I soap the left arm, then I soap the right arm. I mean, and then I soap my body in a particular order. Then I rinse the shampoo off, and I put on cream rinse, conditioner, and I do everything in order. That order is being driven not by me, but by something inside my brain that says this is the order you do things. In fact, sometimes if I forget to do a piece, I'll get confused. I'll go, well, my brain says that I put the conditioner on, but the conditioner bottle's still up here in the corner, and it's usually not there if I have put it in. So no, I didn't follow that script completely. If you drive to campus, you have a script that you follow. You probably drive the same way every day or most of the days. And oftentimes you'll know you're driving from a script inside your head. If all of a sudden you realize you can't remember passing Lakewood or Bellflower or any of those off-ramps, but you know you must have passed them because you're at school. That's working from a script. So the idea behind sexuality is that the theory, again, this is just a theory, the theory suggests that over time we build up scripts about how sex should be. And we watch TV, we hear our friends talk, we get information from a variety of sources, and we think we've built up this script of how sex should be. I don't know if this movie's on Netflix, I never checked, but if you want to see a good example of this, there's a movie on that was out a few years ago called Men, Women, and Children. It was a bomb of a movie, although it was fascinating. It featured Adam Sandler as a dad and of one teenage boy, and Jennifer Garner as the mom of a teenage girl. And part of it that had no relationship to sex is Jennifer Garner's made her daughter print out all of her email every day and all of her text messages every day so that she could make sure that everything was going to be okay. She was one of those helicopter moms. And Adam Sandler was sort of a hang loose dad who used porn. And it turned out his son used porn, unbeknownst to him. And when his son finally got a chance to have a girl in bed with him, he didn't really know what to do. His script was built from watching porn, and the stuff he watched on porn was no resemblance to being next to this young girl in bed with him. And so his script just fell apart and he couldn't perform. It's a real good example of how script theory would explain that and what happens. So the third theory is called cultivation theory, and you have to think of gardening here, basically. If you're a gardener and you're growing things, I grow vegetables sometimes. If you're a gardener and you're growing things, one of the things you know you can do is you can cultivate the ground around the vegetables or the herbs or whatever you're growing, the flowers, whatever. And the more you cultivate it, mix it up, add stuff into it to help it grow, break up the clods of dirt, makes it grow better. George Gerbner came up with this theory to explain why we build up these ideas about sexuality from, particularly from television. He was a communication specialist talking about television. And the idea is that over time, we start by watching TV that shows sexual activity or talks about it, and we start cultivating these ideas. And then we add more and more and more and more and more, and we cultivate more and more and more and more and more. And finally, we develop our attitudes towards it. It's an interesting theory. It bears much more in communication and television theory than it does for the internet, but it still is a plausible theory, and we have to do research to support. So another issue that I want to talk about is sort of a byproduct of sexuality, and that's sexting. And I mentioned Dr. Michelle Druin's name earlier, and I recommended highly that you read her Q&A at the end of chapter 4 because it's very insightful and also because it'll be on the test. But she defines sexting as the transmission of sexually explicit material via text or internet message. It's a pretty broad definition, but basically what it says is sexting is anything that transmits sexuality. And I leave sexuality as a broad category because it could be words, could be music, sounds, it could be pictures. You can send a picture of yourself. You can get people to send pictures themselves to you. So how prevalent is this? 88% of adults have sexted, and 82% of adults have done it within the last year. But 3/4 of the people are in committed relationships and only 40% of people in casual relationships. For adolescents, these numbers are variable. And on the average, about 25% have gotten online sexual requests, but look at the range of results from 9% to 60%. So we don't really have any good data on this yet. It's equally among boys and girls, but girls feel more pressure to do it. And boys feel more pressure because they're trying to increase their social status that they got some girl to send a picture of herself doing something sexual or being sexually provocative. Only 14% actually produced images, meaning it's not as prevalent as people might think. But one of the things that's interesting is that they did a meta-analysis, and I don't know if I've explained meta-analysis, but a meta-analysis takes all of the research that's done on a topic, puts it all together into one study, and analyzes it as one big picture. Okay, so there might be 20 studies on sexting. If you put them all together and look at the pattern across all of them together, statistically you can figure out that the trends right now for sexting is that those who do more sexting have more sexual activity themselves, more unprotected sex, and more sexual partners. Then there is a series of other little interesting issues that I wanted to throw in here. See these apps right here in the middle of my screen? Those all look like calculators, don't they? Except they're not real calculators. They're fake calculators. They're called vaults. And if you click on it, a calculator will come up. Or if your parent clicks on it, a calculator will come up. And if you know which order to click on numbers in the calculator, it will open up, and behind there will be stored pictures. This is where kids can store sexually explicit pictures. So that's an important issue, and people have been talking more and more about that. Particularly, we'll talk more about that when we talk about parenting. Another issue is sexual orientation, and this is a burgeoning area of study that I want to spend a moment talking about. Sexual orientation is tricky. Facebook has a billion different ways that you can list yourself and what your gender identity is, but also behind your gender identity comes your sexual orientation. And one of the interesting areas of research that is somewhat in its infancy is how people are using sexual media, feeling safe and anonymous behind the screen, to be able to evaluate and assess their own personal sexual identity, sexual orientation. What this means is that they can try out things online. It's that sexual identity formation that they're trying to strive for, but they can be anonymous. They can go into chat rooms where nobody knows them, and they can talk about maybe feeling like they might be straight, or they might be gay, or they might be bisexual. And this is one of the positive benefits, starting to become more research on this, of being behind that screen. Where being behind the screen may no longer be negative, may be positive because of the anonymity, because it lets you feel free, because in the terms that are used in the book, it lets you feel disinhibited. So that's very important. Another issue is cybersex. And interesting enough, I was looking for research yesterday on cybersex, and there's just not a lot of research on it. Basically, this is having sex in front of the computer, sometimes with a person at the other end, live person at the other end, sometimes with a video at the other end, but it's basically sex alone. So it's sexual masturbation alone. Nobody really studies this very much. The closest that people come to this is studying the effects of pornography. And this is basically on the edges of that. Another issue is sexual predators. And we'll talk about this more later because there's been some predominantly large research studies over time about sexual predators. There's been a TV show out there, I don't know if it's still on TV, called To Catch a Predator, where they used to have a young girl or a young boy entice somebody through email or text or social media to come meet them. And they were underage, and they would bust them, and whole thing. They would show the police dragging the guy away. We'll talk later about the statistics, but sexual predation is fairly small, is fairly insignificant compared to other forms of sexual expressiveness on the internet. And so the studies that have been done are waning in, and more often you're going to see studies of sexting or other similar kinds of studies. Catfishing, I just want to touch on briefly. It's discussed in the book. Catfishing is basically describing yourself as somebody who you're not. I think there's still a TV show called Catfish. But what commonly happens is somebody will get on and engage, say, pretend to be a young girl and engage a young boy and keep pretending and pretending and pretending and then get the person to meet you, and it turns out they're not who you thought they were. This is very real, by the way, and happens a lot, and very dangerous. In a few cases, it's actually led to suicide, although in the predominant number of cases, I think it probably leads mostly to embarrassment. But I do know somebody who was catfished, and he thought he was talking to this young girl, and she invited him to come visit him in somewhere in the Midwest, I forget where. And he flew all the way there and contacted her, and she said, "Oh, I'm too busy today to see you." And the next day, "Oh, I'm too busy to see you. I've got to take care of my mom." And the third day, he had to fly home and never saw her. And it turned out her wasn't a her, it was a guy. He was just playing a very cruel joke. And then the last thing is something I just want to briefly mention is the way sexuality is treated in the school system. And most school systems have a program called abstinence only. It's designed to encourage kids to not have sex until marriage. It's a standard program. The interesting part of it is the results show that in general, those kids who go through an abstinence-only program end up having intercourse earlier than those who don't. Parents seem to think, in many cases, that talking about not having sex encourages kids to have sex because it's against parents' wishes, against teachers' wishes. But in general, the lure of the internet is too strong for abstinence-only programs to work. Pornography is just a tap away. Social media is just a tap away. All these sites, Tinder, Grindr, all these are just a tap away. And they're all available. All you have to do is say, for many of them, just say, "Yeah, I'm 18, sure, I'm 18. I may look 13 and be 13, but I'm 18, and at least for this website." So I have about 10 minutes left, so I want to talk a little bit about internet addiction and we'll talk more about this later. In psychology or in psychiatry, there's a manual called the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, the DSM. And in the manual, they list diagnostic cues or symptoms of people who have certain psychiatric disorders. In general, if say you're looking at obsessive compulsive disorder, there will be a list of 9 potential behaviors or thoughts that you might have. And if you indicate that you have 5 or more of those 9, then you are considered to have symptomology of obsessive compulsive disorder. Internet addiction is not a diagnostic category. Although in the last version of the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual version 5, they did include online gaming as needing further study. They put it in what they call the appendix, needing further study, meaning, yeah, we'll wait until we get some more studies about it, and then next year we'll put it as a diagnostic category in there. But people have tried to look at internet addiction, and ask yourself as I'm going through these, yes or no, does it fit you? Are you preoccupied thinking about the internet or thinking about anything on the internet? Do you spend increased time on the internet, on your phone, to get the same level of satisfaction? Have you unsuccessfully tried to stop using your phone too much, the internet too much? Are you restless and irritable? That's a typo. I hate typos. Ah, being a writer, I hate typos. Restless, irritable when trying to cut down. Do you find yourself staying on longer than intended? That's the sort of, I'm just going to check my social media and I'll be off in 5 minutes, and 2 hours later you come downstairs. Have you jeopardized loss of relationships, a job, school by using the internet or the phone or the tablet too much? Do you lie to families and others to conceal how much you use it? Do you use it to escape problems, to relieve depression, anxiety, etc.? So what do we have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Oops, let's go back. So this one's 8 different categories. This is done by Kimberly Young, who started this field back in the 1990s. And ask yourself, do you qualify for 5 or more? We'll talk later in the semester about the biology of addiction, but this is more the psychology and behavior of addiction. It's not the only way to look at addiction. There's another way that talks about a few factors. One is salience. Is your smartphone the most important thing in your life? Many people will say yes. Does it help you escape a bad mood? Or the opposite, are you irritated if you're not online or using your phone? Do you need more and more? Do you develop a tolerance for it? Do you need more and more time on your phone to feel just as good? Do you get in a bad mood when you're not online, on your phone, on your tablet? And have you had attempts to control it that led to relapse? And a lot of these definitions depend on the activities. Gaming is very different than social networking, smartphone, and texting. There's been a lot of studies. Let me come back to me here for a second. There's been a lot of studies on internet addiction. And the term internet addiction is somewhat passe at this point. It's often now called smartphone addiction, or it's called problematic internet use. You'll see that in the book. Regardless, when they look at the prevalence in studies, it ranges, depending upon who they study, from 1% or 2% up to 15%. Much more common in men than women, not surprisingly, and much, much, much more common in Asian countries than Western countries. They have a huge problem with online gaming in South Korea, and in China, and in Japan. In South Korea, they have, if you are considered to be an online gaming addict, they'll send you away to a camp where they basically deprogram you so that you stop having those feelings. There are several ways to look at this in terms of theories again. And if I can come back to the screen, let me talk about at least a couple of the theories here. These are different than the theories I've talked about before because it's a different situation. First theory is called holding power, which proposed by Sherry Turkle, who's a MIT professor of psychology, sociology, anthropology altogether. She did a lot of the earliest studies on how people relate to technology, even taking the game Simon to the beach and having kids play the game Simon and then talk about their experience with playing a game with technology. She calls it holding power. What she says is the reason that you cannot, that you are addicted is because the technology itself has holding power. It keeps you there. So what about a game might keep you there? Well, if you look at some of the old games like Pac-Man or games like that, they're quite different than the games now that are much more realistic. And she would say they have much more holding power. They will hold you there and grab you in. Other people talk about a plausible cause as a combination of this anonymity and disinhibition, that you're behind the screen, you feel less inhibited in playing, you get into the game, you're really playing that game, you're really going with the game, and you have friends who are playing the game with you. A lot of the games these days, Minecraft, Fortnite, things like that, are designed to be played with friends, and that is also a strong draw to become more addicted. And then there's an interesting theory called terminal time warp. Sounds like a little something out of Star Trek. But terminal time warp is really, I think, quite normal in the sense that you experience time differently. If I had you right at this moment, close your eyes and to yourself think nothing, just let your brain go blank, and then asked you to raise your hand when you thought a minute had passed, I guarantee you that most of you would start raising your hand after about 25 or 30 seconds, and all of you would raise your hands after no longer than about 45 seconds. We have a strange view of time. And time is a mysterious thing that itself is constant, but in our head it's not necessarily constant. And so terminal time warp would be that you think you're just going to be playing this game for an hour, and 16 hours later you realize you're still playing the game. That's a good example of terminal time warp. And then finally, in terms of treatments, in these Korean, it's interesting, in these South Korean treatment centers, there are a few treatment centers, by the way, in the United States. There's one in the state of Washington, and there's one in the state of New York, and there's a couple sprinkled around the United States, but not very many. They typically use two different kinds of tools. One is called cognitive behavioral therapy, which basically asks you, cognitive means thinking, behavior means changing your behavior, so you need to change the thoughts, how you're thinking, in order to change your behavior. That's what cognitive behavioral therapy is. So if you have thoughts like, wow, this is really, you know, a great fun thing to do to be playing this game, and I love hanging out with my friends this way, and it's really not hurting me, what cognitive behavioral therapy would say, we need to change those thoughts in order to change your behavior. Straight behavioral therapy would just change the behavior. Straight cognitive therapy would just change the thoughts, put them together, you change your thoughts in order to change your behavior. And then the second one is very popular in South Korea. It's called reality therapy, where basically they drill in you that you have to assume responsibility for your own life, for your own behavior, for your own reality. You have to take a look. They videotape you playing and say, this is you. This is your reality. This is what you look like. You're here glued in for hours and hours and hours on TV playing a video game. This is not good. And so reality therapy would confront that in a strong way in order to drag you from your version of non-reality into reality. So I think we're going to wind it up for today. Just a little bit of a review. We've talked about the impact of technology from television, videos, etc., on sexuality. We've talked about some of the theories behind it. We've talked a little bit about internet addiction. We'll talk about that later on. And next time, we're going to talk about the impact of technology on your emotional health, on your mental and emotional health. That'll probably take a couple of lectures because there's a lot of data on that and a lot of interesting data on that. So again, don't forget that you're working on reaction paper 1. due the 14th of February. Need to do two activities, go take the online survey, and then go write the paper. If you have any questions, email us. Thanks very much. Have a great day.